5, 6, 0.
Well, 5, 6, 9.
Everyone, welcome to tonight's evening prayer. And as everybody begins, why we start out with praising to God. Most gracious, kind, loving Heavenly Father, we're so thankful that you've gathered us here together tonight so we can worship and hear the word and praise your holy name. Be with those that are traveling, give them travel mercies to protect them, so the holy angels to be there to guide them as they come in safely. And we thank you in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
We will sing song and the hymnal, page 569. Pass me not, O gentle Savior.
Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory.
God be the glory. Thank you all for coming.
Amen.
What a weather, what a blessing.
Amen.
I'm so happy. We're going to pray. And we're going to pray for a few moments, asking for God to search our hearts. Also pray for me and my family. We will be traveling tomorrow. After we pick up our daughter from school, we'll be traveling to San Bernardino for Camp Cedar Falls. You ever heard of that? They're having a retreat for 4 days, and I'm one of the speakers and four other speakers. So I'm very, very excited. God is going to do amazing things.
Amen.
We're going to talk about how God brings freedom from bondage. So I'm excited. I am excited. So please pray for me and my family as we travel. At this moment, we're going to pray. You don't have to kneel, but just meditate and ask God what is in you, what is in me, that we need the Holy Spirit to sever from our hearts, whatever that sin might be. Okay? Let us pray at this moment. Father in heaven, as we are searching our hearts, Lord, if we are honest with ourselves, we all need help. That's why we're so grateful for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We learned last night that love for God, one through one, giving his son. What a blessing. I pray, Lord, that you'll be with all of us. As we hear the message tonight, may the Holy Spirit work on our hearts. Lord, if we committed any sin in your presence, we ask for forgiveness and cleansing from all unrighteousness. We pray that you will be with Pastor Skeete in a very powerful way, that you'll speak through him and give him clarity of mind and speech, and may you put your words in his mouth. Lord, we just love you so much. You are amazing. We ask that you continue to be with us. Lord, bless us. And Lord, may Jesus Christ be lifted up. In Jesus' name we pray. Let every child of the King say,
Amen. Amen.
Troubled. You believe in God? Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Thomas said unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also. And from henceforth ye know him and have seen him. Philip said unto him, Lord, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us. Jesus said unto him, Have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father. And how sayest thou then, Show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, He doeth the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth in me, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go to my Father. And whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. If ye love me, keep my commandments. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
That is good.
Psalm 100 verse 5, for the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. As long as there is God, there will be truth.
Amen.
Which means truth will indeed endure to all
generations.
But one day, and I must say this, error, the opposite of truth, will cease.
Amen. Amen.
Along with those who persist in living their lives by error. One day, error will cease. Along with those who persist in living their lives by error. But I thank God for truth.
Amen.
Because truth is life. The Bible says in Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 4, God is the God of truth. In John 14, 6, Jesus says, I am truth. In 1 John chapter 5, verse 6, the Bible says, the Holy Spirit is truth. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost are truth. To be a child of heaven, you must be a child of truth.
Amen.
How was your day?
Blessed.
Blessed. Anyone had a particularly hard day? Raise your hand. You had a particularly, but your presence in this place tells me the Lord brought you through. Amen. Come on, say amen for us.
Amen.
If we had no trials, we would hardly feel the need to pray. You really would. When someone wins the lottery, they don't start crying with tears and praying. We cry on our knees when a family member is at the door of death. When the doctor says you have cervical cancer or cancer of the prostate, that's when we pray and cry. Let me tell you something. The time to pray hardest is when things are going well.
Amen.
Are you listening to me?
Amen.
You must learn to pray. The Bible says in Hebrews 5, verse 8, Jesus prayed with strong crying and tears. It's good to see you.
Same here. Same
God bless
here.
You. Thank you very much for loving the Word of God.
Amen.
And for loving God. Is there anyone with us tonight? You are not a Seventh-day Adventist. You are here for the first time. Raise your hand. First time. You are not a Seventh-day Adventist. All right? You're here for the second time. Give us your name again.
Mary.
Mary is a good name. Yes, I remember saying that is the name of the mother of Jesus. Mary, thanks for coming back. God bless you. I mean that. And may God bless you so much that it draws your heart even closer to him.
Amen.
Anybody else? All right. Our subject for this evening, a divine partnership. What did I say?
A divine partnership.
What was last night's message?
The tough love.
The what?
The tough love.
Very good. What was the message before that? Tuesday.
Near my God.
Blessings upon you. You have a tenacious memory. Mission impossible made possible. All right. Are you ready now to worship God?
Okay.
In spirit and in truth.
A divine appointment.
Divine partner.
Before I pray, please turn your phones off. When Uzzah touched the ark, what did God do?
Killed him.
Why?
Because he disobeyed the command not to touch.
Well, this disobedience was an act of disrespect. Respect God. Please respect him. You know, God says, thou thoughtest that I was altogether such a one as thyself. God is not like us. That's why the Bible says, my ways are not your ways. My thoughts are not your thoughts. As high as heaven is above the earth. That's the difference between you and me, says God. And so respect God, always, in church and outside of church. But particularly in his holy temple. If you have one of these, I encourage you to use it. If all you have is a phone, make sure it does not ring in the presence of God. Amen. Favor number two, while I'm speaking, pray for me and say, Lord, put your words in that man's mouth. That is based on Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 9, which says what?
Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth.
And the Lord said
unto me, Behold, I have put my words in thy mouth.
Here's a student who has been working. I give you an A because you're an Adventist. All right. Favor number three, think while you listen. Isaiah 1:18, come now. Let us do what?
Reason together.
I thank God for being a reasonable God. I really do. He's a reasonable God. You know, in a sacrificial system, you could bring a bull, a goat, turtle dove, or flower, according to your ability.
Your means.
That's a reasonable God. God could have said, I want everyone to bring a bull. What would happen to the poorer classes? We serve a reasonable God.
Amen. Amen.
So Paul says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God. Finish the verse. Which is your reasonable service. We offer reasonable service to a reasonable God. Head bowed, eyes closed. My brother from Belize.
Oh.
Come and pray for me.
Oh.
Ask God to use you, please. That He alone will have the glory. Heads bowed, eyes closed.
Father God in heaven, we thank you so much for this opportunity to come into your house of worship. Lord, we lift up Pastor Skeete in a special way. We ask that you would touch him in a special way, Lord. And please put your words in his mouth so that we can receive the message that you have in store for us, that we can be blessed and have a closer relationship with you tonight. We pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you. God bless you and your family.
Thank you.
A divine partnership. Let's go to Jeremiah chapter 10. We'll read from verse 3. It's 11 minutes to 7. We're in good time. Jeremiah 10, reading from verse 3. Jeremiah 10, reading from verse 3. When you found it, say amen.
Amen.
Read with me, what does it say?
For the customs,
of the people are vain. Stop. The Hebrew word customs means ordinance or statute. So God called the Passover an ordinance. In other words, the religious rites and rules and laws of the heathen are vain. Remember, Abraham kept my commandments, my charge, my statutes, and my laws, Genesis 26:5. The word statutes is the same word for customs. For the customs, the religious practices and principles of the heathen are vain. For one cutteth a tree out of the forest, the work of the hand of the workman with the axe. They fasten it, they deck it with silver and with gold. They fasten it with nails and with hammers. Why?
That it might
that it move not, because the thing is dead, it's lifeless. All right. They are upright as the palm tree, but speak not. They have what?
They must needs be born.
They must needs be born. Why?
Because they cannot go.
Be not afraid of them. For they cannot do evil. Neither also is it in them, that is the verse,
to do good.
Do not be afraid of false gods, says the true God. They cannot hurt you. You know, in my travels, I go to certain countries where people are terrified of spells and curses. You can't put a curse on a child of God.
Amen.
Amen.
You can put a curse on a church member. Not all church members are children of God.
True.
You can put a curse on someone who has a habit of going to church. You cannot put a curse on someone whose life is in the hands of God.
Amen. Amen.
You can't put a spell on a child of God. So God says, be not afraid of them, for they cannot do evil, neither also is it in them to do good. Don't go to the witch doctor. There's nothing good he can do for you. You're wasting God's money. Jeremiah is describing false gods, images made by man. You cut down a tree, you shape it in the form of a cow, a horse, a man, decorated with silver and gold, which is jewelry. And you worship. Verse 11. Here's what God tells Jeremiah. Thus shalt thou say unto them, the gods that have not made the heavens and the earth, even they shall perish from the earth and from under these heavens. Now God distinguishes himself from false gods in one major way, and that is, he can create and they cannot.
Amen.
The gods that have not made the heavens and the earth, even they shall perish from the earth and from under these heavens. Verse 12. He hath made the earth how?
By his power.
He hath established the world how?
By his wisdom.
By his wisdom. He hath stretched out the heavens how?
By his discretion. Discretion.
Verse 13. When he uttereth his voice, there's what?
A multitude of waters in the heavens.
And he causes the vapors to ascend from the ends of the earth. He maketh lightnings with rain and bringeth forth the what?
The wind out of the treasures.
He creates, he controls. This is Jeremiah saying, the true God is the one who can create.
Amen.
Isaiah 45. Let's read verse 18. Isaiah 45, reading verse 18, our subject, a divine partnership. Isaiah is just before Jeremiah.
Verse 18.
Isaiah,
verse 18.
45. Verse 18.
Amen.
For thus saith the Lord that created the heavens, God himself that formed the earth and made it. He hath established it. He created it not in vain. He formed it to be inhabited. Finish the verse.
I am the Lord, and there is none else.
Meaning, there is none else who can do what?
Create.
Let me say it again. There are many things God can do. Foretell the future. Save. The thing that God uses to distinguish himself more than any other of his qualities from false gods is his ability, come on, tell me,
to create.
To create. And how does he create?
By his words.
Speaking. Yeah. Psalm 96. Psalm 96. Psalm 96, verse 5. You have that? Not yet.
Amen.
Psalm 96, verse 5. When you found it, say amen. Amen. Read with me. What does that say?
For all the gods
of the nations are
idols.
Finish the verse.
But the Lord made the heavens.
Here again we have creation distinguishing God from false gods. Now, the Bible is telling us only God can create. The Hebrew word for create, bara, is used only of God in the Bible. Only God can create. Let me say it differently. Only a divine being can create. If that's clear, say amen.
Amen.
Right. Point number two. Let us go and hear what God has to say about Jesus. Hebrews 1. We're about to read what God tells his son.
Hebrews
one of the most unusual chapters in the Bible, Hebrews 1. Read it sometime or read it microscopically. And then read chapter 2, the two go together. Hebrews 1. In Hebrews 1, Christ is presented as higher and above all angels and created beings, and they are mighty angels. Remember when one angel came down at the tomb of Christ, there was an earthquake. Remember, one angel killed 185 of Sennacherib's soldiers overnight. One angel is a powerful being. Christ is above all angels. And that's the point being made in Hebrews chapter 1. Let's read verse 7. Let's read from verse 1. From verse 1. We identify two people in that chapter. Are you ready?
Amen.
Hebrews 1, verse 1. Let me pray. Father in heaven, as I enter into this very, very important chapter, be with me, God, that I speak what's correct about you and your son. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
God, who at sundry times and in diverse manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his son. So we have God speaking, then we have God speaking through his son. So we have God and the son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. Now, think hard. Listen to verse 2. By whom also he made the worlds. You have to really concentrate. Now, who is referred to by whom?
God is referred
to God the Father. By God, by whom also he made the world. Now, is that correct? I want to look a little closer. By whom also he made the worlds.
Jesus made the worlds.
Jesus is the whom. Jesus is the whom. Now, who used the whom to create the world?
God.
God. By whom also he. So God created by Jesus. Are you with me?
Amen.
Now, verse 3 continues to speak about Jesus and the Father. Who being the brightness of his glory. Who is that who? Jesus. He's the brightness of whose glory?
God's.
The Father's. We have two people. Who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person. So Christ is the brightness of the Father and the precise reflection of his glory and upholding all things by the word of his power. Who is the his power? Jesus. When he that by himself purged our sins, who is the he by himself?
Jesus.
Sat down on the right hand, come on.
Of the majesty on high.
Majesty on high, that's Jesus. You must distinguish who's the Father and who's the Son in the first three verses. Being made so much better than the angels, as he had by inheritance a more excellent name than they. Now, for unto which of the angels said he at any time what?
Thou art my son.
Thou art my son, come on.
This day have I begotten thee.
Now, who said that?
God the Father.
God the Father. So the writer of Hebrews is saying, to whom did God say that? Did he say that to one of the angels? What's the answer?
No.
To which of the angels said he at any time, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee? He never said that to an angel. And again, keep reading. I will be to him
a father,
and he shall be to me a son. Did God say that to an angel? No. He said it to Jesus. Now, still with me. And again, when he bringeth the first begotten into the world, he saith what? Let all the angels of God worship him. Him. Who said that?
God did.
Father. What did he tell the angels?
Worship his son.
Even though he is in human form. Notice the verse said, again, when he bringeth in the first begotten into the world, when he sent Christ to be human and to live in God, the angels still worship him. Because he was human and God. The Father said, don't worship him. Mm-hmm. Are you following me?
Amen.
Look at verse 7. Read for me.
And of the angels, he said, who maketh his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire?
That's what they are. But, verse 8, unto the Son he saith, read with me,
thy throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom.
What does the Father say to the Son? Read it for me, verse 8.
But unto the Son he said,
he saith what?
Thy throne, O God.
Who has a throne?
God the Son.
Generally speaking, who has a throne?
Jesus.
A king. Well, that's what Jesus is. Which means the Son sits on the throne. Finish my words. For the Father. Because there are three kingdoms. There are two. The kingdom of God.
The kingdom of Satan.
The kingdom of Satan. The Son and the Father are co-rulers.
Co-rulers. Okay.
And so the Father said, thy throne, O God. What does the Father call the Son?
God.
God.
Amen.
Now, with such a plain verse, how can people say Jesus is less than God? Thy throne, O God, is for what? Ever and ever. What is he saying about Jesus?
He was eternal.
He's eternal. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of thy kingdom. You have a kingdom, you have a throne. Verse 9. God is speaking again to the Father, speaking to the Son. Thou hast loved righteousness. Come on, read with me.
And hated iniquity.
Therefore, God has anointed anointed the oil of gladness about thy fellows. Now, listen to the Father. He continues to speak. Remember, we established only God can create. Remember that? Or, listen to what the Father says to the Son in verse 10. Nice and clear. Read for me.
And thou, Lord, in the beginning hast laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the works of thy hands.
Stop. Listen to Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Listen to Hebrews 1:10. Thou, Lord, in the beginning, hast laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the works of thy hands. Quick question for you. Who said, let there be light?
Jesus.
But he said it for whom? Come on. He said it for whom?
The Father.
He was the Father's agent. Mm-hmm. But the fact that Jesus could create means that Jesus is. Don't hesitate. Jesus is
God. Or divine.
I'm not saying Jesus is the Father. He is fully God.
Yes.
Thou, Lord, in the beginning, hast laid the foundation of the earth. And the heavens are the work of thy hand. Listen to verse 11 now. Read with me. They shall
perish.
Come on, read.
But thou remainest.
What do you understand by they shall perish?
Be no more.
They'll come to an end. But thou remainest. What does that mean?
Live forever.
Live forever. It's the opposite. Are you following me?
Amen.
They will perish. You know that. Mm-hmm. But thou remainest. And they all shall wax old as the garment. Your ears shall not fail. Mm. God the Father recognizes his Son as equal with himself.
Amen.
Let's see how human beings on earth recognize Jesus. Or recognize what Jesus said. John 5. Let's go to John 5. Our subject, a divine partnership. John 5. Remember the man who'd been sick 38 years at
yes.
the pool of what?
The tester.
Yes. And Jesus healed him. And the Pharisees were upset because the healing took place when?
On the Sabbath.
On the Sabbath. And they asked the man, what man is that which said unto thee, take up thy bed and walk? And he that was healed wist not who it was, for Jesus had conveyed himself away, a multitude being in that place. Verse 13. Now we go to verse 14 of John 5. Are you there?
Amen.
John 5:14, you may read with me.
Afterward, Jesus findeth him in the temple and said unto him,
sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. Let me pause and digress. Christ is connecting sickness with sin. Mm.
Yeah.
Read what Christ said to that man. Just the red letters in verse 14.
Behold, thou art made whole. Sin no more. Lest a worse thing come unto thee.
What do you mean by a worse thing? A worse sickness. Sickness and sin go together. Let me say something nice. It may not always be your sin. Huh?
True.
But living in a world of sin leads to sickness. Obedience to God will protect us from that.
Amen. Amen.
Your amen was not very healthy. Come on, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Obedience to God is the best health practice you can follow.
Amen.
All right. Sin no more, lest the worst thing come unto thee. The man departed and told the Jews that it was Jesus which had made him whole. And therefore did the Jews persecute Jesus and sought to slay him. Why? Because he had done these things, come on
the Sabbath.
On the Sabbath day. Now, let's read microscopically verse 17. But Jesus
answered them
what?
My Father worketh
hitherto,
and I work.
If you read that in several versions, it becomes clear. Christ told them, God the Father has always been working and he's working right now.
Mm.
You see, if God the Father ceases the work, everything collapses.
Right.
If the Son ceases the work, everything collapses.
Mm.
What Christ is saying, my Father has always been working, and he's working up to this very point. And he worked for me to heal that man on the Sabbath.
Amen.
I work. When he said my Father works and I work, the Jews understood immediately that he was saying what? I'm God the equal. Read verse 18 now. Come on, clear. Nice and loud. Make me happy. Read. What's it say?
Therefore the Jews sought to kill him.
Because he not only had broken the Sabbath, but said also God was his Father,
making himself equal.
They understood that when he said, my Father worketh hitherto and I work, that he was saying we are equal.
Mm-hmm.
They understood that. Because that's considered blasphemy by the Jews back then. And the punishment was stoning by death, death by stoning.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
So they understood that Christ said, I am equal with the Father. Go to John 10. John 10, quickly, 8 minutes after supper. Our subject, a divine partnership. John chapter 10, we read from verse 30. You have John 10, we're in John 5, John 10.
Amen.
Verse 30, let me say a prayer. Father in heaven, please continue to speak through me very distinctly, I pray, for your glory and our blessing in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Read with me, my friends. I plead with you every night. You read the first word and you die off very nicely. All right. John 10, verse 30. What does that say?
I and my Father are one.
Not the same person. We are equal. Now, the Jews understood that. Verse 31. What does that say? Nice and clear.
Then the Jews took up stones again to stone him.
What do you understand by again?
They did it the first time.
They were always trying to kill God. Nothing new. Then the Jews took up stones again to stone him. Keep reading for me. What does it say?
Jesus answered them, Many good works have I showed you from my Father. For which of those works do you stone me?
Keep reading.
The Jews answered him, saying,
For good work we stone thee not, but for blasphemy.
And because of thou being a man, makest thyself God.
They understood again, he was saying, the Father and I are equal. What have we established tonight? One, God's number one defense of his divinity is the fact that he can do what?
Create.
God the Father himself declared Jesus to be God and the Creator.
Right.
Jesus himself in his word declared that he and the Father are one. Are you with me?
Amen.
If you're with me, say that.
Amen.
Now, go to John 14. We were in 5, we went to 10, now we're in John 14. I told you before, it's a beautiful book. To understand Father-Son relationship between God and the Son, read John. Prayerfully and microscopically. John 14, let's read verse 28. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
Read with me with your lovely voices. What does that say?
Ye have heard how I said unto you, I go away and come again unto you. If you love me, you will rejoice because I said I go unto the Father.
Now carefully, clearly, finish the verse.
For my Father is greater than I.
Found out prior to this.
That they're equal.
What does Jesus say?
My Father is greater than I.
We have to understand that. Let's go to John 17. We're still in John. John 17. Let's read from verse 1, just to read the Word of God. John 17. We read from verse 1. I want only the men to read. Only men and boys who have the King James Version. Are you ready?
Amen.
Read with me these words.
These words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven and said,
Father,
the hour is come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. as thou hast given him power over our flesh, that he should give
eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. Now, verse 3, carefully, men, read on.
And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God,
now listen carefully,
and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent.
What did Jesus say of the Father? My Father
sent me.
Sent me. Go to ladies, verse 8. John 17, verse 8. Ladies, are you ready? Read with me, ladies, your lovely voices. What does the word say? For I have given unto them the words which thou givest me, and they have received them. Come on, and know that I, and they have believed thou didst. The Father said. Altogether, verse 25. Read for me.
O righteous Father, the world hath not known thee, but I have known thee.
And these are known
that thou hast sent me.
I can give you verses upon verses upon verses that show Jesus said, the Father has sent me. Mm-hmm. Now, let's go to John 13. We're still in John.
John 13.
And oh my God, you're fascinated by John.
John 13.
John 13, yes. You have John 13?
Amen.
All together as a church family, let us read carefully verse 16.
16.
Are you ready?
Amen. Verily, verily, I say unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord.
Stop. Is that true? Yes or no? Yes. Who has more authority? The servant of the Lord.
The Lord has.
He will
neither he that is sent that is said, greater than he that sent him.
There's a light bulb going off in here.
Mm-hmm.
But we need more support. Stay in John chapter 15, read verse 20.
John 15, 20.
John 15, verse 20. Amen. Read with me now. What does it say?
Remember the word that I said unto you. The servant is not greater than his Lord.
Now, Jesus says, the person who sends is greater than the person
who is sent.
What he means is, has more authority. Answer me now. Here's God the Father. Here's God the Son. Who sent whom?
God the Father, sent the Son.
Even though they are fully divine, who has greater authority?
The Father.
Yes. By the way, that's a pattern for Christian homes. The husband and the wife are fully human.
Right.
But as a reflection of the image of God, the husband has greater authority. Which means he must be quick to give his life for his family.
Amen.
Are you following
him? Amen.
Did the man go to sleep?
Amen. No, we're here. We're listening.
Because that's the way Jesus
so we heard
is the woman of the church. Are you with me?
Amen.
Right.
Amen.
Now, because the Father has greater authority, everything belongs to the Father. Go to John 17.
Amen.
We'll also find out something about what belongs to the Father. John 17. Let's read verse 9. John 17. You have it?
Amen.
Let me pray. Dear God, please continue to speak through me. As we learn, let us commit our lives to you, even during the service. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Read verse 9, everybody, together.
I pray for them.
I pray not for the world, but for them
which thou hast given me,
for they are thine.
And all mine are thine, and thine are mine.
Now, everything the Father has, because Christ is our ruler, is also Christ.
Amen.
Now, when we talk of salvation, what is sin?
Transgression of the law.
Now, answer me correctly this question. Transgression of whose law?
God's law.
The Father's law.
Yeah.
The Son's law too, yes, but what I say in the context of salvation, let's say you came to my house, you spent the weekend, and you damaged my car. My Mercedes Benz 2020 model. And you're nervous. You need an advocate. Who do you go to?
My wife.
My wife. So please talk to your husband for me. I know he's a member of the NRA, so he has guns. Please. Talk to your husband for me. And when she comes to me, what am I going to do? Are you with me?
Yeah.
Now, God loves you. Come on, say that.
Amen.
But you cannot get around his law. If God could have gotten around the law, there would have been no need for Jesus. So when churches tell you the law has been done away with, they're saying the sacrifice of Christ was a waste of time. God cannot get around his law. And as much as he loves, he must acknowledge the law has been broken. In the periodical West Indian Messenger, July 1, 1912, paragraph 5, Ellen White writes, "The only question asked in the judgment will be, are they obedient to my law?" What does the brother of Jesus say in James chapter 2, verse 12? "So speak ye, and so do, as they that shall be judged by the law of liberty." Live as though you understand that one day you will be judged by the standard of that law, which is an expression of the righteousness of Christ. And so Jesus, he came to this earth, lived a sinless life, went back up to heaven, and now offers that life on our behalf. When we give our lives to him. You see, you can't go directly to God, neither can I. Why? Because we're sinners. Or we've done wrong. You understand?
Amen.
We still have a carnal nature. We need an intercessor.
Right.
Who can I go? Jesus. The instant Adam sinned, Christ began to function as an intercessor.
Amen. Amen.
No man cometh unto the Father but by me. John 14:6. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5. "For there is one God," verse 4, "and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus." That's why, my little children, these things write I unto you that you sin not. But if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus.
Amen.
Why is Jesus able to advocate for us? Because he lived a perfectly sinless life.
Amen.
He fulfilled what the law of God demands. And the Bible says in Psalm 19, verse 7, "The law of the Lord is perfect." Follow me closely. The law of the Lord is perfect. If the law is perfect, what kind of life does the law demand?
Perfect.
A perfect life. What does the Bible say of all of us? All have
sinned and come short.
And come short. The glory of God was seen most frighteningly on Sinai. When the whole mountain was on fire and smoking and shaking. You know why? That wasn't the first time God had come down. God would appear in the tabernacle. He appeared to Moses. But it was the first time he came down with the law. He brought down his holy law. That's why there were thunder, lightning, and smoke. And the Bible said, and Moses said, "I exceedingly fear and quake." The knees of Moses were knocking like a tambourine. Because God brought his holy law. When the Israelites saw what was going on, You know what they told Moses? You speak to him. And then tell us what he said. Because if we try to speak to him, he'll kill us. You know what God told Moses? Take heed unto thyself, that thou go not up into the mount, or touch the border of it. There was supposed to be a rope on it. Whosoever touches the border of it, man or beast, it shall surely die.
Right.
Including the little children.
Hmm.
So don't let your little children run around the church. Innocent. If a little child had touched that mount, it would drop dead in all its so-called innocence.
Mm-hmm.
That's the holiness of God's law. All of sin. All. Then, no matter how much you get converted and stop sinning, you can't change the fact that at some point in the past,
you did sin.
You sinned.
Yeah.
A perfect life means you have
never sinned.
Never sinned. Only Jesus can say that. That's why only Jesus can advocate for us.
Amen.
Because he absolutely fulfilled what the Lord requires. This plan is the plan of the Father because he loved us.
Amen.
For God so loved the world, come on,
that he gave his only begotten Son,
that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Wow. There is a relationship between Christ and the believer. Inasmuch as he done it unto one of the least of these, my brethren, come on, finish it.
You've done it unto me.
Now, this is a reality. Whatever you suffer as a child of God, Jesus feels.
Amen. Amen.
The Desire of Ages, page 823, paragraph 4, the servant of God writes, Christ feels the woes of every sufferer. When fever is burning up the system, he feels the agony. Why? Because he still has human flesh. This relationship between Christ and the church, which is so close, so that he can say to Saul, 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 come on, tell me.
Why persecutest thou me?
And he said twice. And Saul said, who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. You're persecuting me. Because I am the head of that church. That church is my body.
Right.
If someone shoots you in the leg, you don't say, no, well, you shot. No, just my leg. You don't say that. Just my leg. I wasn't shot. Just my leg. I was shot.
Yeah.
Now, that closeness between Christ and the believer is a reflection of the closeness between the Father and the Son.
Amen.
What the Son feels, come on, tell me.
The Father feels.
The Father feels. When Christ was bleeding through his skin in Gethsemane, and suffered, that's where he suffered. That's where he prayed three times. If thou be willing, remove this cup. He did not see that on the cross. On the cross, he was busy serving, saving one thief, busy making housing arrangements for his mother, and busy forgiving those who crucified him. On the cross, it was not him. In the Garden of Gethsemane, get me out, get me out, get me out. When he was bleeding through his skin and suffering, what do you think was happening to the Father?
He was suffering.
But he couldn't ignore his Lord. He was suffering with his Son. When I was a little boy, I had to get some sort of injection. So my mother took me to the clinic. I was small, and the nurse sat me up on his desk. And my veins are small, so she couldn't, so she stuck and found nothing, and she stuck and found. And after she stuck me twice, I noticed my mother started to cry. I was small, 7 or 8. I remember that. Then she stuck me again, and now I didn't cry. But my mother cried. Because this was hurting her, come on. More
than you.
Let me tell you something else. Christ left the Garden of Gethsemane. went to the cross. He suffered on the cross. Don't misunderstand. He suffered too. And then, what happened? He died. Are you with me?
Mm-hmm.
When he died, what happened to his suffering?
Ended.
It ceased. What happened to the Father's suffering?
Ended.
No. What happened to the Father's suffering? It continued. Because he had to see his Son.
Oh, that's true. I thought of it that way.
The Father went for all that. He cannot ignore his law. That's a divine partnership. Christ intercedes on your behalf before the Father, who, despite his impossible love for us, cannot ignore his law.
Amen.
Because the foundation of God's throne is his law, the law of righteousness and love.
Amen.
My brothers and sisters, when we understand the cost of our salvation, the suffering Jesus went through, and the Father went through, and the angels suffered, they loved Jesus. He was their commander steward. The Holy Ghost, we're told in Hebrews 9:14, Christ through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God. All of heaven suffered. When you say no to Christ, then you understand these words. How shall we escape? Come on. If we neglect so great salvation, the only proper response for someone who says no to that kind of salvation is hell. When you look at all that heaven suffered, you realize hell is the proper response for someone who rejects it.
Verse 10:14.
God devised a way to save us. He sent someone equal with himself to atone for his broken law. Because the law cannot be changed. To change the law, you have to change what? God. And I am the Lord.
I change not.
Tonight, Christ still knocks on our hearts. Give the life to me. Since a perfect life means never any sin in the life, not even once, and only Christ has lived that life, when you give your life to Christ, this is what Christ covers you with. But you must be in him by constant surrender and obedience from the heart. He covers us with his righteous life, and the Father looks at us and he sees Christ's life. Literally. You know, Ellen writes somewhere, it is not important or so important what God thinks of you. What is important is what God thinks of Jesus. In Revelation 3, go there with me and let me close. Revelation 3. We read verse 5. Revelation 3, verse 5. 7:32. I'll pray one more time. Father, as I come to the close, continue to tell me exactly what to say in these closing seconds. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Revelation 3, verse 5. You have that?
Amen.
Read with me.
He that overcometh.
He that overcometh stuff. Overcometh what?
Sin.
Sin. You and I have only one thing to overcome. That's sin. Now, it may express itself in alcoholism, in whatever, but the only thing we need to overcome is sin. To him that overcometh, will I grant to sin. Read verse 5, what was that saying?
He that overcometh,
the same
shall be clothed in white raiment.
And I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will do what?
Confess his name before my Father and before his angels.
Yes. Jesus said, the person who has accepted me and dwells in me through daily surrender, I will speak for him to my Father.
Amen.
And anything presents to the Father, the Father accepts.
Amen.
If Jesus says, Father, this soul has accepted me, fine. Father, he has confessed his sins, but he loves me. He is trying by my grace, the Father says, fine. Jesus says, Father, for the first 60 years of his life, he was a drug addict. Now he got to know me, and it's a struggle for him. He keeps falling, but it is hard to overcome, the Father says, accept.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Because he's in you. It is dangerous to live outside of Christ. Many of us live in the church, but outside of Christ. The life must be surrendered to Jesus. And this must be the thing that dominates us all during the day.
Amen.
When someone cuts across on the highway, am I a child of Jesus? When your boss treats you like whatever, am I a child? Did that happen to Christ? The answer is yes. I asked you last night, the night before, give your life to Jesus. You say to me, how? And I say to you, just tell him, Father, here is my life. And if you don't know how to say that, simply say, Lord, I don't know how to give my life to you. You take it.
Amen.
That he won't kill you physically. You take control of your life. You take it. That's what you say. If you're unable to say, Father, I surrender my life 100%, you say, Father, I don't know how to do that. You come and take it with my permission, and he will do that.
Amen.
Every day is a brand new lifetime.
Amen.
Here's why I say that. How does the Bible represent sleep? Or death as a sleep? What do we do every night?
Sleep. Practice death. Practice in death.
We're dead. When God opens our eyes, that's a brand new lifetime. Are you listening to me?
Amen.
Then give that life to Christ. Every time you open your eyes, you've awakened from a kind of death. It's a brand new life.
Amen.
How many will say with me, Father, to the best of my ability, I recommit my life to you fully. Can I see your hand?
Amen.
Fully. Stand with me. The most intelligent decision you can make is to allow Christ to lead your life. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Father in heaven, we thank you for making an arrangement for us to be saved, for us to be reconciled to you despite our sin. That arrangement is Christ. When we accept him and his sacrifice, and his sinless life becomes our covering. When we are fully surrendered to him. Forgive us, God, for hurting you so much. Forgive us, Father, for sinning, embarrassing you behind in the presence of all the evil angels and all the holy angels, Father. Our sin embarrasses you, like some children embarrass their parents when they flunk out of school. Please, God, forgive us. We cling to Jesus tonight. He's our only hope. Without him, we cannot be accepted by you despite your love. And so tonight we'll wrap our arms around the cross, and we will not let go, even though you say to us, as you said to Jacob, let me go, we will say no. Because to let you go is to let go of life. So we hold on to that cross tonight, Father. We surrender to you, we ask you, God, have mercy upon us.
Please.
Because of Jesus to whom we've given our lives.
Please.
As we leave this place, let us leave knowing there is someone standing before you, equal with you, advocating for us.
Amen.
And if he tells you that we're fine with him, then we're fine with you.
Amen.
Let's leave with that assurance to God. And as we contemplate this arrangement, let us hate sin. Protect us as we travel. Bring us back tomorrow, may God, to hear your word again. We pray in Jesus' name. Let God's people say,
amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Joyful, joyful. God of glory, God of life. Joyful, joyful. Number 12 in the hymnal.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Travel safely. God willing, we'll see you tomorrow.